Hello everybody and welcome to another episode of Stable Diffusion Experimental. Today we'll be taking a look at how we can now apply Houdini-like Z-Depth manipulations and generate animations that only involve depth, for example, in a way that before now was mainly made with 3D. We're gonna start off with something easy like this, and then we're gonna move on to something a bit more complex, like blending two different animations together. The workflow looks complex, but the inputs are really only two, and everything else is automated. Same as always, you will be able to find this workflow in the description below, as well as any other models you might need. But before we proceed, I wanted to shout out the creator of the node pack with which this is all possible. The node pack is ComfyUI Ryan on the inside, and it brings so many new tools that are not only Z-Depth related, but also particle systems, audio features, optical flows, temporal effects. There's so much new stuff here that I feel like this will be the first in a series of videos dedicated to finding out what's possible out of what's been usually a 3D prerogative in the generative AI field. Ryan also has a YouTube channel where he publishes some tutorials about his node packs, so be sure to check him out. The first thing I did for this workflow was creating a starting asset. At first I wanted to start with a chrome-like solid, but then I thought, well, I am a product and fashion photographer, so why not go for something that is much closer to what I normally do? And so I generated this Coca-Cola can floating in front of a backdrop, and well, I guess if you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. So for this hammer in particular, everything looks like a product photography pipeline. So let's have a quick overview of the whole process, and then we'll go into each step individually. The first stage of this process is, on the one hand, creating a video out of a still frame, and that's easy. That's just repeating the single frame an X number of times, where X is the total amount of frames you want, and then creating a movement for the Z depth so that the Z plane intersects with your subject. The resulting intersection will look something like this. Now, of course, I lowered the frame rate just for you to see it a bit better. Out of all these resulting images, we are mainly using the repeated frames as latent, the depth as guidance for a control net, and the resulting frames here as noise masks for our latent. So in each of every step of our generation, only the white parts will be generated. Then right below we have the actual engine of the process, which is very similar to the starting portion of Ryan on the inside's own depth chamber workflow. I changed a few things. For example, I am using only the depth control net instead of depth and line art, and that is because I want the overgrowth on the can to be able to move a bit more freely. I am not using an IP adapter because for what I'm doing, I'm not a fan of using an IP adapter, mainly because the in-painting areas are way too small for me to be able to achieve good results with an IP adapter, at least without lowering the strength so much that it stops doing something. And I left all the animated diff elements as they were in his own workflow because they work quite well as they are. Then we've got the actual inference and generations. I've added the differential diffusion module just so that it guides the in-painting a bit better. And as you can see, if we take a look over here and here as well, the only in-painted areas are the ones that are resulting from the intersection between the Z depth plane and the subject. The first pass is this animation, but it's not as smooth as we'd like to be, and in order to not generate a ton of frames, I'd rather pass it through a Rife VFI node, and that's a frame interpolation node that just adds some frames in between each frame that already exists. In this case, it's doubling the frame count, so the video is both longer and smoother. This is the base result. There is no manipulation in between different animations. It's just one animation. But I have also included this other part, which is entirely optional if you want, that transition from one generation to the other. So from one animation to the other. In this case, we've got a fire animation on the can and a nice animation on the can. Now, this is still a bit wonky. As you can see, both animations start at frame zero and end at the last frame, whereas if possible, you would like to of course, stop the first animation at around 60% of the frame count and start the second animation at around 40% of the frame count and edit at 100% and then blend the frames in between. But since the nodes that I had access to in order to do that are percentage based rather than frame count based, I was running into some rounding errors, and blending nodes need the same amount of frames on either side, and because of that I just decided to generate the whole animation for both of them rather than keeping banging my head against the math wall. It's a bit more resource intensive, yes, but it still works. This is the end result without Rife Pass for frame interpolation, and this is the end result with the Rife Pass added. It's still not as smooth as I would like it to be. I'm basically adding three different blending strength passes here, depending on where in the frame percentage the animation is happening, but the jump from one to another, it's still quite noticeable. But I'm sure that out there, there's people who are better at math than I am and can figure this out on their own. Now for the actual workflow. First of all, in the input script, we are selecting the number of frames that we want. In my case, that's 32. I find it to be working better with a frame count lower than 60, but you can experiment with it. That's fine, also depending on your hardware. And then you want to load your initial frame. I've left a note here that you can also use a video, but in case you're using a video, of course, you would need to take care of some of the nodes that are used here, like the repeat images node. You wouldn't need that because here I am repeating the same images 32 times, whereas a video, of course, would have an already existing number of frames. I am scaling down the original image to 1 megapixel just not to have too much of a file size. I am getting the 32 frames here. As you can see, they're all the same because the Coca-Cola can is stationary. And then I am removing the background in order to source the subject's mask. I'm using InspireNet, which is a free for commercial use, relatively new model for background removal, which is quite good. Then I am slightly manipulating the mask. I am contracting it by 5 pixels, mainly because it works best with the next step, which is Z-Depth manipulation, but you can experiment with it, you can leave it at zero, do whatever. And these are the resulting subject masks. And since the subject is stationary, they're gonna be stationary. If you use a moving video, for example, this will move. At the same time, I am extracting depth, and I need this for two different things. The first thing not shown here is that I am connecting the single depth frame to the control net depth. That's because I don't need more than one frame for guiding depth in that case. And then I'm using a repeat image batch node to repeat the same depth X amount of times, where X is the number of frames that we have. And then I am passing that depth to both time feature and flex mask depth chamber nodes. These are the two main nodes from Ryan on the inside pack that I am using. The time feature guides the animation through time with a fixed frame rate. You can select the effect time. Like in my case, I just want smooth. I want it to progress smoothly along the time axis. I've made the speed very low at 0.1. And then I'm using those time features to guide the Z depth axis slicing of the Coca-Cola can. Now, how does that happen? Well, imagine Z-depth as a plane perpendicular to the Z-axis. It's like you've got a phone here and you've got a plane going through the phone. The closer or the further away it is from 0, 0, 0. When it's intersecting the phone, it will create a slice of the phone, and it can either only output that slice or whatever's in front of it, or whatever's in the back of it. Instead of taking the whole scene, so background and the Coca-Cola can, it's only taking into account the Coca-Cola can because I'm using the subject masks to tell it that I only want that which is masked. Now, in my case, to achieve this effect, I am using both the Z front and the Z back planes, and I have switched their starting position to 0.5 and 0.3 so that their starting point is a bit closer to what I wanted it to be. Like in my case, I didn't want to spend any time for the planes to actually intersect with the can. I just wanted to start mid action, and the values here are kind of hit or miss. So you just have have to try and play around with it. And then I'm moving both, and that's the feature parameter, and with a squeeze motion. You can use both squeeze, expand, move forward, move back. I am also adding a tiny amount of blur, and that's the grow with blur parameter, and that's because usually differential diffusion works a bit better where there's a bit of blur involved. This is the resulting animation. Of course, it's at frame rate 8, just because I wanted to show it to you a bit slower than necessary, so you can appreciate what's happening here. And we are gonna leave this mask here for now. We'll pick that up later in the generation process. Back in the actual generation process, what we are doing is loading a checkpoint. That's gonna be a 1.5 checkpoint for us, because here we are using AnimateDiff and 3 Loras for AnimateDiff and AnimateLCM. I will leave the link to the download in the description below and in the workflow. You can place them in the models Lora folder. In case you wanted to try using it with STXL or Flux, you would, of course, need to get rid of everything that is related to AnimateDiff, because that's basically 1.5 only, and you'd need to figure out another way to have temporal stability in between the frames, which is not easy. If you can do that, then go for it. Then we have a very simple conditioning step, which is just a positive prompt, very easy, like in this case it's just MOS, because we are only describing that which is in the slicing portion of the resulting mask, and we are applying a control net depth that is based off the original soda can depth. Then we have here an animated diff group with a whole animated diff pipeline. Now, I'm not an expert on animated diff. I found that this works incredibly well, and it's basically what was already implemented in Ryan on the Inside's own workflow for depth chamber, so I left it as is. The only thing to note is that you would need to place these two models, so Liquid AF and Animate LCM, into two specific folders that are not in the models folder. They are placed in the custom nodes ComfyUI AnimateDiff Evolved motion-lora subfolder for Liquid AF and models for Animate LCM. Then you've got the IP adapter group. I already said that I don't personally like doing it, and that's mainly because the resulting mask for the stuff I do is way too small for IP adapter to work properly, but you can enable it if you have a bigger area that's getting impainted. And then we have the actual inference with differential diffusion added and the set latent noise mask creating our latent. Now, what's happening here? Instead of using either an empty latent image or a VAE encode node only, what we are doing instead is taking the 32 frames of the original image, encoding them, and then manipulating that latent with noise for each frame only in the corresponding white area that has been sliced for that particular frame. It's basically a gradual inpainting process that grows or contracts with the mask. This is the result without frame interpolation, and this on the right hand side is the result with frame interpolation. As you can see, that's quite nice. A bit further down, then we have the two different animations that get blended together. We are starting from a very simple prompt once again, which is fire at the top and ice and snow at the bottom. We have to recondition the depth, of course, because while the depth is the same, the conditioning from the prompt is different, so we have to use two more control net nodes. The model is the same, so we just need to pick that up from the previous groups. We proceed to the same inference process, and we get our resulting animations both for fire and for ice. And then what we are doing here is basically separating the image interval into 5 different intervals. Now you'll see 8 here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, but these 3 are the same in couples, so that's 1 and 1, 1 and 1, 1 and 1, and these 2 are different. That's the starting frames, that's the ending frames. We want to take only the first 25% of one of the two animations and the remaining 25% at the end, so that's from 75% starting stage to 100% of the other animations, and leave them as is, as the starting and ending point of the resulting animation. And then we want to take all the middle points, so that's between 25 and 40%, between 40 and 60%, between 60 and 75% of both animations, same frames, and blend through them, so that the resulting blend is starting off more and more like the first animation and becoming more and more like the second animation. And these are the results of the combined frame in a video. On the left one, we have the basic one without frame interpolation. And on the right, we have the frame interpolation with Rive. So all in all, I think this is an absolutely brilliant note pack. And maybe that's only because I had a brief excursion with Houdini and particle effects and Blender and all of that. But those who know particle systems, Z-Depth manipulation, maps and masks based manipulation systems, all of that, I think can appreciate what's possible with this. This is incredibly unidirectionable. And this is something that was only doable with 3D basically up till now. What we are basically doing is 3D like animations with 2D images only. And while I haven't tested properly particle systems and optical flows that are all possible with this note pack, I will definitely test them out because this opens up a whole new range of possibilities. Like, for example, think about controlling animations based on audio inputs without going through Touch Designer, for example. Or creating vellum-like animations based on particle systems and relative position maps. That would be absolutely amazing to me. So that's going to be it for today. I want to thank all of the people who are supporting me on Ko-fi. And once again, I want to shout out Ryan on the inside. Go check out his GitHub and YouTube channel. You can find the links in the description below. If you like this video, remember to like and subscribe. My name is Andrea Baioni, and you can find me on Instagram at ReasonBushi or on the web at andreabaioni.com. And same as always, I will be seeing you next week.